That's why I'm here today, because I'm excited about talking with you and giving you anything of value I have to offer you that will benefit you. And by the way, you need to know that I don't speak about things that I haven't experienced. That's very important to me. I like to walk the talk before I talk the walk. And everything I'm going to talk to you today about is something that's been really important for me. There's a lot of different things I could say, but one of the things I want to say right at the get-go is that your greatness lies outside your circle of comfort. So those areas in your life that you're pushing up against that seem like a challenge, guess what? Right over that line is where your greatness lies. That's true for all of us. The biggest challenges that I've had in my life, sometimes the biggest disappointments, have been those areas where it's really created the kind of person that I really wanted to be in the first place. So your greatness lies outside your circle of comfort, and every day you are either preparing or repairing. So every day I try to think about that. And one of the keys to life, as I think, is to continually, all the way through life, maximize your talents. And the way you do that is by committing yourself to a couple of habits. One is the habit of lifelong service, because that's why your talents were given to you in the first place, to serve other people, whether it's Don Kanabi as a public servant or whatever you're doing, fire, whatever you're doing, you're there to serve other people. And the second thing is lifelong learning, because leaders are learners and learners are leaders. And as soon as you stop learning, you stop leading. And I'm talking about leading yourself as well, because we talk about leadership as influence. How can I influence you to get you to do what I need you to do? Now, that's a good thing, and we do it in a proper way, but self-leadership, which has already been mentioned up here, is how do I lead myself? What are the thoughts, the behaviors, the strategies that help me exert influence over myself? Because I've discovered that I'm my biggest problem. I get in my way. More than you get in my way, I get in my way. And I want to give you one skill that I think is so important, and that's all I'm going to leave you with today, and two habits that go along with that skill. They're really habits. They happen, and they're also attitudes, but they happen on a daily basis, so I call them habitudes. I'm not sure if that's a word, but it should be. These are habitudes that we need in life. And that skill that I'm talking about is the skill of managing my moods. Every day, I need to learn how to manage my moods. 80% of your success is going to be in your ability to manage your mindset so that you will do something positive with the things that confront you, whether they're difficult or whether they're easy. And one of the ways you do that is through this habit of realizing that action comes before feeling. The reason I say that is because you're a lot like me. You've known what to do. You've known how to do it. You know that you ought to do it, but you didn't do it. What happened there? Your moods mastered you instead of you mastering your moods. The key here is this. Movement eats feelings for lunch. You have minimum control over your feelings, maximum control over your behavior, so you emphasize that over which you have maximum control. For instance, if I wanted to get up in the morning and go work out, if I'm waiting for the feeling to get up and go work out, I'll skip most of my workouts. So it's mind over mattress in this sense. I must master my moods. And I discover that my ability to move creates the moods that I really want in the first place. Let me give you an example of that. But your body, your physical body, by the way, has the ability to change your moods. We know this is for a fact. Moods create feelings. The less we move, the less we feel. In fact, if you have total rigidity with no motion at all, we call that death. That's what death is. So the more you move, the more you feel. So you get up and you start moving. Pull the covers. Sometimes I feel like pulling the covers over my head. Instead of doing that, I move against that, get up and start moving, and the feelings begin to come. Let me give you an example of that. Sit up real straight in your seat. Real straight. Now, take a deep breath. Now, let it out. Take another deep breath. Let it out. Now, to put a big smile on your face, big one. I mean big. Now, turn to the person next to you and start laughing. Do it. Go ahead. Do that. Out loud. Now, at the same time you're doing that, I want you to say, I am terribly depressed. You can't do it. It's impossible. So your movement creates your moods, the habit of acting before feeling. That's important to understand, to get moving in life. To whatever you don't feel like doing it, get up and start moving, the feelings will come. People sometimes say that smoking calms them down. But it's really not. It's the nicotine actually speeds you up. It's the deep breathing of smoking that calms you down. So it's that, again, the habit of acting before feeling. Get up and you start moving. And that's a key thing if you want to change your moods. Let me give you a second habit that's extremely important as well that will help you master your moods. That's the habit of self-affirmation. Self-affirmation. How do you talk to yourself? You're talking to yourself constantly, all day long. Chatter's going on in your head. Nothing goes by you without some commentary from you in your head, some question, some judgment. And you need to listen to what you're saying to yourself. If I said to you, and I could say this in different ways, if I said, I think you're mistaken, that would impact you a certain way in how your feelings would be. I could say, instead of, I think you're mistaken, I could say, I think you're wrong. Or I could say, I think you're lying. That would impact you a certain way. Just as that would impact you, the way you talk to yourself impacts you a certain way as well. And you wouldn't believe some of the things we say to ourselves. I call it monkey chatter. Swinging from anxiety to fear to self-doubt and all the other things. You know, we have this, I call it the Oz syndrome. In fact, I describe myself that way. Big and powerful on the outside. But when you pull back the curtain, you see a little guy in there pulling all these levers, feeling very inadequate about himself. That persona's big, but the person inside wasn't too big. And so what I'm talking about today is making sure that person is as big as the persona. In fact, it will impact that persona. How you talk to yourself is very important. You need to listen to how you talk to yourself, because some of the things you say to yourself are asphyxiating. They pull you down, and they're not true. Some of the things you say to yourself are affirming, and it's what you focus on that's very important. What you focus on, listen to this closely, what you focus on is reality for you, whether it's true or not. I'll say that in a more complicated way. What you focus on is reality for you, even though it's not reality and actuality, which is simply a way of saying what you focus on is true for you, whether it's true or not. My son and I had the privilege of going down to the Fontana Speedway and getting in those Formula One cars and racing around this track at 165 miles an hour. That might not be fast for some of you, but for me, my fillings were falling out of my mouth. It was unbelievable. And it was scary. And they gave us 5 hours of training before that. We had to put on the fire suits and the helmets and the whole thing. And they give us all this safety instruction. They put us in the car, jam the steering wheel in after we get in the car because there's no room to get in after the steering wheel's in. And then they said, throughout that 5 hours of training over and over again, whatever you do, when you're going that oval curve at a high velocity, whatever you do, do not look at the wall. Because if you look at the wall, you will crash into the wall. What you focus on is what you're going to go toward. Instead, focus on where you want to go. Don't focus on what you fear, focus on what you want. And that's the same thing with our self-affirmations, the kind of things we focus on, the kind of emotions we focus on. What do you want? Do we focus on anger? Do we focus on rejection, resentment, frustration, self-pity? Or do we focus on gratitude? I'm so grateful to be here today to talk to you. I really am. In fact, I could get emotional just talking about it right now. I really do feel grateful. It's not just, oh, I'm grateful for this or that. I feel grateful to be here talking with you today. How about cultivating the state of passion? Be passionate about what you're doing. Don't be bored in life. Be passionate about what you do, whatever it is. It might change, but be passionate. Be compassionate. Be empathetic. Those are the kinds of things you want to focus on. Be humble, which doesn't mean thinking less of yourself. It simply means thinking of yourself less, because you've got a lot of good qualities, again, all those good qualities. So again, what you focus on is important. Let's say if I had a bucket of water up here. How could I get the water out of that bucket? Well, I could take that bucket and toss the water out, but life doesn't work that way. Life doesn't change overnight. So each day, what I have to do, habitudes again, each day and throughout the day, I drop a little pebble in that bucket, an affirmation. You know what? You are good. You do have worth. You're here for a purpose. You are talented. You have things going for you. You have value that people need. And every day as I drop that into that little bucket, that water gets displaced. And that's what I'm talking about. Two things again. The habit of acting before feeling and the habit of self-affirmation. Those are so important for you. They're habitudes. You won't learn them overnight. You'll hear them now, but as you practice them, you'll begin to own them. And the quality of your life is based on the quality of the emotions you experience on a day-to-day basis. And secondly, what you focus on is true for you, whether it's true or not. So focus on the right things. And when you do that, you're going to provide for us the things that we can benefit from. And you have so much that we want from you that we can benefit from. And you can't do that if you're not focusing on those things. I love you. Thanks for having me today. This has been great.